r/AskReddit. Lawyers of Reddit. What are some of the strangest would it be illegal if I questions you have been asked? There's the old drinking man's DUI avoidance scheme that people ask my wife, who used to be a PD and is now an adder, about all the time. You're drunk driving and get pulled over by police. The second you get pulled over, you 1. Cut the engine and step out of the car with a full bottle of whiskey, preferably JD, as the square bottle ensures it hasn't rolled out of reach. 2. Throw your keys far away, preferably in the woods or down a sewer grate. 3. Open and pound the whiskey in front of the officer. In theory, you would only get a public drunkenness, as they can't prove you were drunk while driving. You are simply drunk on the side of the road and not in possession of your car. In practice, you're going to jail for DUI, obstruction, and whatever else they decide is appropriate for being a pain in the ass and making it harder to tow your car. My dumbest cousin tried a variation of this. He got drunk at home, ran out of booze, and went to the store to get more. On the way back, he crashed his car into a ditch and then got out with the ear and decided to walk home. When a cop pulled up on him drinking one of the ears, he insisted that he was sober at the time of the accident, probably some 10 minutes ago, and that he only opened the ear for the walk back home. Cop bought the whole story and gave him a ride home, and even had his car towed back for him. Just kidding. The duckin' idiot definitely got a DUI. A friend of mine would fall off the wagon into a week-long bender about every 4 or 5 years. It would invariably end when he went to jail. One of those times, he wrecked his car into a pole while drunk. He just got out and ran. They caught him the next day and arrested him for leaving the scene of an accident instead of DUI. His lawyer told him it was the smartest thing he could have done. Client is the subject of a protective order prohibiting him from being within 100 feet of the protected person. He tells me he has a laser rangefinder and makes sure he is complying by taking line of sight measurements of his distance from her. By bouncing the laser off her, I had to tell him that is literally compliant, but worse in the mind of the court than just not complying. Please either stop doing that or raise more money to deal with the hitstorm coming when she notices the laser dot on her. So, there's a legal version of "I'm not touching you." I'll make that argument for money. In college, my brother and his friends would do some deep thinking on this subject after many hours of drinking. They would then call the police non-emergency line and play ask an officer. The best one I remember was, "Is it illegal to eat a dog?" The officer said she didn't know, but not to. The next day, brother received numerous calls from different shelters and charities offering to take his dog. My brother didn't own a dog. My brother didn't own a dog. Well, not after that night's dinner. Did he own not an entire dog? A good friend is a lawyer. While we were on a guy's weekend abroad, he got a text, went quiet and texted something back. I asked if it was work related. And yes, it was a client who wanted his lawyer to pass on some information about where the client had hidden his stash. My friend responded simply, "Sorry. I think you understand that I can't do that." The client stupidly thought that the lawyer's confidentiality was a backdoor to using him as a tool in the drug dealing business. That's a really, really, really stupid thing to ask your lawyer to do as well. Primarily because it can violate lawyer/client confidentiality, which can open your communications to surveillance by the police. By asking a lawyer to participate in any way in an ongoing criminal enterprise, you effectively end the lawyer/client relationship and turn it into a criminal enterprise relationship, which, quite obviously, has no protection. So Better Call Saul is all a lie. No. No. You cannot leave the state with your children when you have an open social services case. Yes. You will be arrested if you do so. My mom tried to convince my brother to take his kids and move out of state and then file for full custody in the new state, just to piss off his soon-to-be ex-wife. Divorce proceedings were already in progress, and he only had visitation with supervision. I begged him not to listen to her. Thank God my husband finally got through to him and explained that 1. My mom is not a lawyer. And 2. He is a terrible father who can't stand his kids when he does have them, in much nicer words. I'm pretty sure that would be kidnapping charges. probably complete with Amber Alert etc, and is fairly common. I was eating lunch and this girl opened a can of soup. One of those fat ones with the chunky bits that rhymes with Progresso. She pulls out a giant branch. Turns to me and says, "Can I sue for this?" I say sure. You would win too. As letting a large stick like that trough the machine is clearly negligent. I then asked her if she bit it and chipped a tooth or something. No. Then your damages are the value of a can of soup. Are you still going to eat the soup? Yes. You got no damages. By giant branch you obviously mean something that can fit in a soup can. Was it just a vine from some sort of legume in the soup? It was a woody stick. Not so much a question. But there is a massive amount of misinformation regarding the law relating to intoxication and consent. Many people toss around this idea of if you're drunk you can't consent. This isn't true. Generally, the law is that you can consent while intoxicated so long as you can appreciate the nature and quality of the act. Basically, you can consent so long as you know you are having sex with the person you thought you were. There may be some weird laws in a few jurisdictions, but this is generally the way it is. I figured some of that information wasn't accurate. Not that I support people being taken advantage of, but I also would think everyone should have a reasonable amount of responsibility to provide slash deny slash withdraw consent. Saying drunk people can't consent would open up cans of worms in other areas of the law as well. A lot of people seem to think that any degree of intoxication vitiates consent, which is entirely false. Even if you're tipsy and slurring your words, you're most likely capable of consenting. Again, so long as you are aware enough to know you are engaging in X. In other words, dear Googles, do not vitiate consent. Even though you might not have consented absent the goggles. Kind of a fun one. I do a lot of probate and estate planning. And I had a guy who wanted to know if it would be legal for him to take money and other valuable possessions and then divide them up into a bunch of waterproof metal boxes and bury them in his backyard. It was more of a pasture, 3 or 4 acres. Then, he was going to leave his 3 kids each a metal detector to be given to them at his wake. Whatever they found, they got to keep. Technically, at least in my state, it's legal. That doesn't mean that it's not an absolutely terrible idea. My grandfather did a less interesting version of this. He left a bunch of valuables and legal documents, old deeds to the land, old versions of his will, his parents' birth certs, etc, in a slash non slash waterproof box and buried it. But didn't tell anyone. It was a couple months after he died that my granny casually mentioned that she thought he did this, but didn't know where. So I was sent to find it and dig it up. I didn't believe it, of course. I thought my dad was taking the piss and just wanted to see how long I'd wander around a field randomly digging up mails and stuff for. But I found the thing after like 40 minutes. Everything completely ruined. Of course. Cuss of the lack of it being waterproof. But it existed. And it was still quite important stuff, and we managed to at least partially recover large portions of the documents. But then of course, because my grandfather was around, it was buried 1 foot under a shed where everything in the shed was left to one son, and the land under the shed and the shed itself was left to another son. So the question of who owned the contents of the box was legally questionable. We resolved it by not telling either son and just giving the contents to my granny. Jesus. Your grandpa must really love ducking with people just for fun. Everyone wants to know the precise limits of self-defense. To the point of, "Hi, storm a lullaby. What do you do for a living?" "I'm a lawyer." "Oh. So if someone called me an asshole and I punched them, would it be self-defense?" "Every time." Probably the strangest questions relate to fanfiction. Though, what are the questions you're asked about fanfiction? I'm genuinely curious. There are definitely a lot of questions related to making money, but more relate to infix scenarios that the writers want to be accurate. Some examples. I'm writing a fic, and I'm killing X character. Who will get X's money? Y in my fic is a minor. If I want to have Y run off with Z, what could Y's parents do about it? I'm writing a fic about a real person. Can they sue me if I make them have gay X with another real person in my fic? Can Batman actually do these things and not get arrested? The answer is almost always it depends. Except for Batman. The answer for Batman is typically no. But who's going to arrest Batman? Edit. Wow. Formatting is a good thing. Guy punched his girlfriend in the face. Couldn't understand why he got arrested, since she wasn't bleeding. Good lord. You'd be amazed how dumb people who commit crimes actually are. Lawyer here. This is kind of the reverse of the question as it is, hey, can I sue somebody for this? Friend of mine has a brother we'll call Craig, and my friend had told me this crazy story about Craig and a friend of his, Dave, who both live in the States getting catfished by someone in Australia. Craig calls me up one day asking for advice on the following. Craig and Dave are longtime friends who went to elementary school and are now in their late 40s slash early 50s. Dave gets divorced. After divorce, Dave meets a woman online who lives in Australia, but is originally from Wales, and is financially loaded and gorgeous, and 20 years younger than Dave. And they soon fall in love online. She wants to move back to Wales, to open up an orphanage for children she will be bringing back from Australia. She and Dave get quite involved, and Dave decides he is going to sell all of his belongings and his house in America, and move down to Australia, to surprise her without telling her. So at roughly the time Dave is going to fly down to Australia, there is some kind of hurricane or other disaster that hits one part of Australia. Although not the part Dave's Welsh lady friend lives in. So Dave arrives in Australia and his lady friend is stuck on the other side of the country. Dave meets one of her friends who is a middle-aged woman. Roughly Dave's age, who lives in kind of a rundown house in the middle of nowhere. Welsh lady gets tied up for what turns into weeks, but she keeps in contact with Dave. Dave, running low on money, gets Craig to wire him $2,000. Completely coincidentally, the Welsh woman has an amazingly beautiful sister who is a rich and powerful lawyer who gets introduced to Craig online via Dave. Craig and the second Welsh woman fall in love, and Craig decides he now wants to move to Australia to help them move the orphans from Australia to Wales. Craig sells a bunch of his personal property and drives 5 hours. To meet a private jet sent to him his amazingly beautiful Welsh attorney girlfriend. The plane doesn't show. After he's waited in a hotel several days, he then gets a call from Dave. Dave tells him the whole thing is a scam, and that the middle-aged woman he's been staying with is actually catfishing both of them with the fake profiles of the Welsh women. Turns out Dave suspected as much when he asked Craig to wire him the money, but didn't want to say anything. Craig's legal questions to me. 1. Can I sue the woman that Dave went uninvited to visit in Australia for his $2K loan to Dave? And 2. Can I sue the Australian government, because shouldn't they be liable for the actions of their citizens? If anyone knows a good catfishing lawyer, let me know, and I'll pass the info on to Craig. I can get wanting to sue the woman, but suing Australia or Mayo, they'll surely get millions of dollars for winning that case. In my first year of law school, one of the other students in my section asked 3 different professors whether a prostitute could sue you for battery for the XL contact you paid for. Clearly asking for a friend. A very close friend. Law student here. There was a recent case in our country where a guy kidnapped an 8-year-old kid, aped her and then killed her. Had its fair amount of share in the media for quite a while. As the bloodthirsty people we are. Immediately people started trends on social media that he should be given to the public. We should torture the duck out of him, etc. Nothing unusual. Then a family relative asked me if it would be legal if we forced the guy to have a reassignment surgery and then force him to prostitution so that the money we receive from there could be given to female students. It was obviously one of the easiest duck I know s in my life. It also freaked me out. Luckily the relative then told me that it wasn't her idea, but a celebrity suggested it, so she asked just in case. Hey, gotta give whoever came up with that points for creativity though. Yeah, Hitler could use such a counselor. Another sad one. But during the financial crisis I was asked numerous times whether a family would still get the life insurance payout if the person committed suicide. Don't most policies have a 2-year waiting period before they'll pay if you off yourself? Yup. If they are vested. Only reason I know this is because my daughter's mom is a funeral director and she handles the insurance payments too for the funeral home. If I was at a nudist beach and a girl was sunbathing, and I accidentally tripped inside her, would it count as ape? I'll answer this question. As bizarre as it is, with an actual case that established an important principle in Western criminal law. The accused's name was Fagan, SP. He was pulled over by a police officer and was being ticketed. At some point, the car accidentally rolled into the officer's foot. The officer demanded that Fagan move the wheel. Fagan refused. He was charged with assaulting the police officer. At trial, or more likely on appeal, he was acquitted. Why? All crimes have mental element, mens rea, guilty mind, and physical element, actus reus, guilty act. In Fagan, the court recognized that the mens rea and actus reus element of a crime must coexist and overlap. At one point, in Fagan's case, the wheel accidentally contacted the officer. Fagan then formed the intent to keep it that way. But because he did nothing, there was no guilty act. This is why lawyers like me have jobs. We make arguments after the fringes of the law. So, you can apply these principles to the hypothetical beach scenario and see what you think the result would be. I'm pretty sure you got it backwards. Fagan was found culpable at appeal the moment he realized that he was on the officer's foot and refused to move. The conviction was shifted from assault to a continuous act of battery. Okay, so, dude walks into my office with only his shirt covered in blood. Says he needs to speak to any of the lawyers. So they send me. Sits down in conference room. Looks straight up at me. Raises an eyebrow and says to me, "Is it illegal to stab someone with their consent?" I give him a short answer and half a long answer. He smiles and nods. Leaves the room. And passes the receptionist the equivalent of about $40 in cash and leaves. We don't charge for first time consultations. Edit, to clarify. It wasn't actually the question which was the weirdest one I got. It was more of his behavior and appearance coupled with that question that made the situation the strangest. Edit 2. To everyone who's not sure what I meant by $40 equivalent. I meant that he paid $40 in our country's currency. I'm not from the USA. That's funny. B/C Someone asked that same question on Reddit a couple days ago. Wonder if it's the same guy. Probably not. You'd be surprised the amount of people that ask similar/the same weird questions. Ducking, like, and subscribe.